Yeah, let's start. My name is Johan Andrén. I'm from Sweden. I live in Stockholm. I came here yesterday, and on my way to the airport, or on my way to the bus to the airport, there was a car that ran into this huge water pus. So I was already in a bit of a hurry, and it was like literally like someone would throw a bucket of dirty water onto me. So I had to run home and, you know, change all my clothes because they were really wet, and I didn't bring a belt. So if I drop my pants, please excuse me because they don't kind of stay up. How many of you know what Akka is? It's pretty much everyone. How many of you have used Akka? Okay, that's like quite a few anyways. So I'm going to talk about a little part of Akka, right? Not all of it. But let's just quickly go through what all of it is. So it's a toolkit for building concurrent and distributed systems. And it's based, like the core thing with it is the actor model, which is was first written about in a research paper in like the 70s, and then it was implemented in Erlang in the 80s, 90s, something like that, at Ericsson to build very resilient telephone systems. And then we have a bunch of other things in there as well. So Actors allows us to use the same programming model to build distributed system across many nodes as locally. And it does so by not kind of hiding the consequences of having networks and separate machines, but rather kind of making them a core part of the model. If you compare it to RPC, for example, that kind of tries to make a method call look like it's a local method call, even though it goes across the network. We also have a bunch of tools on top of this cluster. So we have like CRDT, distributed eventually consistent data structures, and sharding, where you can split a huge set of kind of users, for example, over many, many nodes when they don't fit inside the memory of one node. Persistence makes stuff that will reach the same state when you restart the machine. A full HTTP implementation, which is asynchronous on top of actors and streams, and a bunch of more things. And everything in there has full APIs for both Java and Scala. I'm personally very much in love with Scala since 5 years ago, maybe. But I can also see why people like Java better. So you can use it from either language, and the experience will be pretty much the same. Okay. So another kind of sidestep before we start talking about Akka streams is reactive streams. Have you guys heard about reactive streams? A few. So reactive streams was an initiative that was started out in late 2013, where a few of my colleagues and ex-colleagues in the Akka team came together with some Twitter people, and it was a group of people forming around the idea that we wanted to have a kind of specification for streaming stuff asynchronously and how to interface between libraries that could do that. So they worked on a TCK, like a test suit, to seeing that something fulfills this kind of specification, and APIs, of course. And in parallel with that, there was like 5 implementations that were built so that you would actually find whatever problem you could find with the ideas in the specification before kind of setting it in stone. So in April 2015, the first version 1.0 of the spec was released. And then a bit later in 2015, it came into this GEP, and it's included in Java 9 when that comes. So it's actually like the specification and the sample implementation of some of the stuff in it. So what is it? bloody bloody something from the homepage. So let's focus on like the important and interesting parts. So it's stream processing. What does that mean? Well, you have something that emits elements, and possibly an infinite amount of elements. Then you have some kind of processing that you want to perform, transformations, parsing, whatever. And then in the other end, you have something that will consume the elements, right? So that's a pretty simple thing. And then what the kind of core thing says is that it should be asynchronous. What does this mean in this context? Well, it means that between each of these kind of steps in the stream, there might be an asynchronous boundary. So we could have three threads running this stream. And there is one that is doing the emitting of the elements from the source, and there's another one doing the transformations, and then there's a third one doing the consuming, right? And then comes the tricky part, because when you have these asynchronous boundaries, so one thread handing over something to a different thread, how do you deal with if you have a faster producer than consumer? So let's say we had a producer here, a source, that could emit 10 messages per second. But on the far end, we have a consumer that can only accept one message per second. Let's say it writes to a database, and the database isn't fast enough to take more elements than that. Well, we could just put a buffer in there. Problem is that we don't have infinite amounts of memory, so at some point this buffer may go full, right? And especially if we have like a consistently fast producer and consistently slow consumer. Like, it's not about spikes, it's about you will never catch up with the produced elements. Well, we'll put the bounded buffer in there, so we throw away messages. Then we have the problem with like, how do we deal with some kind of guarantees of delivery? How do we, from the source side, know that any element ever got to the sink, to the far end? Right? Because it might just throw all of them away because it's stuck. So this is what the reactive stream specification solves with what you would call asynchronous non-blocking back pressure. So the downstream will always signal demand upstream. And it will never signal more demand that it can handle than that it can handle it. So in this case, the sink would have a buffer of size 6. Then it knows that I can ask for two more elements upstream, right? Because I have space for those, even if I don't complete the currently processed elements. So it sends demand upstream and says, hey, I want two more elements. And the flow can just pass that on upstream, and then the source can produce two elements, but it can never emit more elements than it has gotten demand for. So this way, with a slow consumer, we will back pressure all the way to the producer and force the producer to deal with it. So for example, if the producer is also eating things from a database, it will have to do that in a slower pace. Okay? Pretty straightforward, right? The kind of scope of reactive streams is to be between libraries. So for example, this will allow Akka Streams to compose or be used together with Vertex, which is also an implementation. Or you could use the MongoDB driver, which implements the reactive streams together with any of the technologies which are also reactive streams. So you could kind of consume them and have back pressure all the way to your database, if you would choose to use MongoDB as your database. Thing is, though, it's really complicated to implement these specification APIs yourself. And part of the kind of idea with Akka is to make it, you know, kind of simple to build distributed and concurrent things. And having people implementing these themselves over and over again would not be simple at all. So what you see here, the kind of screenshots, is the set of rules that comes with the specification. So you must fulfill all these rules. And is pretty much only rules about asynchronous kind of behavior. So it's like, when you have done this, you cannot do that, which is really hard to also write your own tests for, which is why there is a test kit. Okay, let's dive into the more interesting stuff. So Akka Streams in Java in 20 seconds. So and I never asked if what kind of languages you're in. How many are Java developers? Okay, almost everyone. Anyone? Scala? Hey, yeah, a few Scala. Great. So I'm going to show you samples in Java, and then I have a corresponding sample in Scala, but I'm not going to go them through. You can maybe, I don't know if they can download the slides afterwards and look closer on them. And also, in the lower left corner, there is a link that will get you to kind of the complete sources for the samples. So you could, when you get your hands on the PDF or some copy of it later, you can actually just fork it off GitHub and play around with it. So there is some boilerplate in the samples that I'm not going to include, except for in this first sample, and that is that Akka Streams always runs on top of an actor system. So the abstraction of Streams is built on top of actors. The other part is that you need a materializer, and I'm going to come back to what materializer is and what it means a bit later. We can just kind of ignore it for now. So let's look at this sample. First, we have a source, which will emit the value, the integers from 0 to 20 million. It will not create like an in-memory collection of all these values. It will emit one value at a time, right? Then it can calculate the next value when there is demand. And you can also see that it has two type parameters, the source. So it has one type parameter, which is integer, because that's the thing that it, thing, the kind of type that it will emit. And the other one is not used, so that's a special type. But there are sources and flows and syncs that will kind of... okay, I'll get back to this, sorry. Just ignore it for now, the second parameter. A flow is something that you put inside of a stream, so you have incoming elements and outgoing elements from it. So a transformation of some kind. And in this example, it will take an integer and it will just two-string it. So it will accept integers and it will emit strings. And you can also see those types in the type parameters in the flow. Right? And then we have the third kind, which is a sync, which is the kind of module that will accept elements. And it has just one type, which is what it will accept. And in this case, it will just, for every element that it takes in, it will print it out to system out. Okay? And here we actually have something in the second parameter. So now like, we can talk about this. Or actually, let's talk about it. No, let's do it right away. So all these three things that you have defined are not, they're not going to run right now. They're kind of a blueprint. So you're creating, just like you're writing a method doesn't mean that it will execute. You will have to call it before you execute it, right? And when you call your method, you will get a return value. So this last type parameter in all these types is what we call a materialized value. And this is something that can be returned when you run the stream. So you can define a stream, and then when you run it, you create a running instance, and it may kind of output a value of some kind. So in this example, it will for each sync, it will emit a completion stage, which will complete whenever it reaches the end of the stream. Right, so you can observe from the outside when the stream has completed. And then we combine these three, the source with the flow with the sync. And they had the types for their inlets and outlets, right? So if we would try to combine something that doesn't accept the right type, we would get a compilation error already here. And what we get back is a runnable graph, which we then can run using the materializer. So sort of we have the types aligning like this. The source emits integers, the flow accepts integers and emits strings, and the sync accepts strings. So it's type safe all the way through this flow-based API. This is how it looks in Scala, pretty much the same. I'm not sure even if it's fewer lines, just a little bit less of types. And of course, I mean, in this simple sample, it's a lot of code just to take like set of numbers and convert them to strings and then print them out. So you can also use a more fluent API. It looks like this. Right, so we can, from a source, we can just map onto a transformation and then we can call run for each on it directly. And again, same thing in Scala, a little bit less verbose, but not a big difference. So let's look at a more kind of meaty sample. So in this case, we have a source which will just keep adding one to a long. So it starts from zero and it will keep adding until it hits kind of long.max and then it will wrap around. And unfold, I'm not sure I'm going to dive into that, but it will essentially take the value it emitted the last time and feed it into the next call of a lambda. So you can make kind of infinite calculations lazily. And then it transforms this number into a byte string, which is basically like an immutable array. So it hides a byte array behind a type, so you can't change it, and it's safe to kind of pass it among threads without problems. So we have a stream of these numbers and a line feed after the number in bytes, UTF-8 encoded. And then this is a bit of a sample of the Akka HTTP API. So we will create a route and the path numbers. And when we get a GET request in there, we complete that request with a response. So pretty kind of self-evident API to define an HTTP endpoint. This response, we will just feed it with the stream. Okay, so when we get a request, we respond, but the body of the response is a stream of bytes. And then we just bind this to a port and an interface, basically. So this is like a complete sample of an HTTP server which will stream numbers forever, as long as you don't close your browser or kill your curl. Same thing in Scala. Also, maybe not such a big difference. So, yeah, maybe this doesn't seem so impressive. Let's talk about this thing with back pressure. So, with TCP, you have buffers on both sides, right? And you have the moving window. So if one side doesn't kind of tell you that you can move on, you can't really send it more packets because you haven't moved the window one step ahead. So this means that in this sample, in like a normal situation, we will just stream numbers and the client on the other side will accept those bytes. But let's say the other end is slow, or someone pauses the process with like control Z on Linux. So then the receive buffer will fill up, and that means that the moving window will stop moving and the send buffer will fill up. And the really cool thing is that this will back pressure all the way up to our source. So if the client is slow, you have back pressure all the way through the server to the source, and the source won't produce more elements than you can push over the network. So without doing any kind of special low-level stuff, this just back pressures all the way through the server. So you could, for example, also think of reading a database, right? You wouldn't want to, usually you will do paging, right? But you wouldn't need to do paging with this. You can just emit elements one at a time or small batches, as long as the clients keep, you know, accepting them in the same tempo. So let's look at a more kind of useful sample. And this is actually based on a on a blog article by this guy, Colin Breck. I think he maybe works for Tesla, a couple of weeks old. So we make a route just like before, but instead of this complete, we will say that we will accept WebSockets. And a WebSocket is basically a two-way flow, right? So when an HTTP client connects and we upgrade to WebSockets, we will get an incoming stream and an outgoing stream of WebSocket messages. So we create a flow of messages, and for every incoming message, we fold it. Why do we do that? Ah, there's two kinds of messages in the WebSocket spec, and one is kind of when you have a strict message. A strict message will have its entire content in kind of one chunk. But there's also a streamed message. So over this stream of messages, one message can contain many chunks, right? So we kind of make that available to you as a developer if you want to do some processing on each chunk in the message. But in this case, we just want to kind of collect it into one message. If the client sends it as a stream, we want to group it together as one chunk because we're okay with that. Like one reason to not do that would be that we collect all this into memory, right? So maybe a stream message will be too large to fit in memory. We would have to kind of pass it on somewhere instead. Then we're going to write this to a database, but we don't want to hit the database like for every message we get because we don't want to overload the database. So let's say we have a bunch of clients and all of them hit us with kind of, you know, sensor data from temperature meter. So we collect up to 1,000 elements into one batch, or if more than 1 second passes between elements, we make sure that we pass it downstream. Okay, so we don't want to kind of wait for the 1,000th element if someone is sending really slow. Then we want to write every second. But if someone is fast, we want to batch them together and make one insert of all this up to 1,000 elements. And then we call an async method, which is in Java then a method that returns a completable future or a completion stage. And in this sample, it takes a list of strings and it returns the same list of strings, but in a completion stage after it has written to the database to kind of confirm, oh, I wrote these to the database. And when we get those, we take the last of them and we send it back to the client as an ACK that we actually wrote it to the database so it knows. Okay. Same thing in Scala. Let's talk about pancakes. So we can set the stage to start with, I think. So we have, I have two colleagues, or one of them is an ex-colleague named Roland Kuhn. He used to be the Akka team tech lead. And the other one is Patrick Nordvall, and he's the current lead of the Akka team, and they both like to make pancakes. But they have very different ideas on how to make pancakes. And we're going to model this with a little stream to talk about concurrency and parallelism. So we'll have a batter source, which will have the pancake sauce in it, and we will take scoops of it and pass them down the stream, and then we will have a frying pan, which fries them, and then on the other side, we will have pancakes going into the hungry sink, which will eat them. So Roland, he likes to do his pancakes in a way that he uses two frying pans, and he fries half of the first pancake, and then he turns it over onto the next pan and starts frying the other side. And then he can, while he's frying the other side, he can put new batter into the first pan, right? So that's like a pipeline of doing a little bit of work and then passing the thing on to the next step and doing a little bit more of work. So this is applicable to things that are not really parallelizable. So you have steps that depend on each other, and you want to kind of do them concurrently somehow. It's also not very good if the steps takes very different amount of time. So this is if you have steps that takes pretty much the same time, it's perfect because you will get a nice flow through. But if you have one step that takes longer time, it will kind of stop up the incoming processing. So this is how we will look in code. We have a flow which will transform half-cooked pancakes. Oh, sorry, scoop of batter to half-cooked pancakes. And then we have another one, which is take the half-cooked pancake and makes a complete pancake. And then we compose those. And what we realized pretty early on is that if you have a synchronous boundary between every stage in a stream, that will almost always perform worse, because there is quite a cost associated with passing an asynchronous boundary, right? So just think about the difference between calling a method locally and taking something and putting it in a shared kind of state and handing it over to a different thread. There's like a context switch and all kinds of not so nice things involved in that. So you don't want to do that except for explicitly where you know that it makes sense in your use case. So in this use case, we already said that we're going to fry the pancakes at the same time. So we're going to put an asynchronous boundary in there after frying pan one, and then after frying pan two. Right? Same thing in Scala. Patrick, he likes to fry stuff in parallel. So he also has two frying pans, but he pours batter in both of them. And then he fries the pancakes and turns them in the same frying pans. And then in the end, he puts them both on a plate. So this is like a fork join, maybe, doing stuff in parallel. It's really good because it's easy to scale. We could just add two more frying pans, and we could make four pancakes at a time and like really increase the throughput. It's bad in that if we have a specific order of the pancakes, okay, the kind of the connection breaks here because pancakes and ordering doesn't really make sense. But if you have things that you want to be completed in a specific order, right, then you would have to have a buffer on the other end and kind of resort them or something. But if it doesn't matter, if you just want maximum throughput, then this is like perfect. So this is how it would look. A bit more messy, and the reason why that is because what we looked at before was the Flow API, we call it. So that is really useful, and it can do stuff with as long as you have linear flows or branches that go into the stream or fork out, but as soon as you kind of have loops or interconnections, you will have it doesn't kind of makes sense. It's hard to build an API that makes that possible. So we have this next step up in complicated, which will allow you to make arbitrary kind of graphs for stream processing. So you can make loops and whatever, feedback loops, for example. So in this case, we create a fan out and a fan in, because we need to split the pancakes out and split the pancake and merge them. And the specific ones is a merge and a balance. So balance will kind of put the next element where there is available pan to fry in. And merge will just join them together into downstream. And then we connect them via this, from this one via this other one to this outlet. So it's a bit more complicated, but still not insane. And here I think the Scala one is much, much nicer, because you kind of can basically draw your graph on a paper and then make it look the same in code. Then of course you can use both of them. So you could actually combine the pipeline with the parallel one. You could have multiple parallel pipelines where you do a step at a time. And I mean, you could do other kinds of options as well. So you could fry one side, and then you could join, and then you could fork again to kind of redistribute the load of half-fried pancakes. So there's, pardon my friends, shitload of stages in there that comes out of the box. I'm not going to go through them because there's so many. But since they all compose, you can often, when you have a problem that isn't covered by an existing stage, you can just take one or two or three of them and combine them into a new kind of source or a new kind of flow that will help you do whatever you want. So, but sometimes you have things that you want to connect in ways which no one anticipated. So you have two dogs and you want to connect them with a cucumber. That doesn't come out of the box. Then we have two things. The first thing is Alpaca, and it's kind of a community project to build a bunch of connectors to different technologies. So you could say a modern camel, sort of. And what is already in there is a connector to Cassandra, Kafka, RabbitMQ, DynamoDB, a bunch of other Amazon technologies, JMS, FTP files. Yeah, you can see. And there's also a bunch of stuff coming in. As recently as today, I was talking about someone with someone about a CSV kind of parsing and rendering stage. So a lot of the things that you might want to do, you could do with a connector from here, right? So there, this would be a source or a sink that connects to a database or AWS Lambda to process something in a function on Amazon. Sometimes you truly have a unique use case which isn't covered. And for this, we have the Graph Stage API. So I showed you the Stream API, which is kind of simple. And then we have the Graph DSL, which is more complicated, but allows you to do complete whatever crazy graphs you want to build. And then we have the Graph Stage API, which is a public API, which is how all the pre-built stages are built. So this is the API we use ourselves to kind of write transformers and different things. So in this case, actually, the Java one is so chatty, so I'm going to go for the Scala one to explain it. So first, we implement graph stage. That's a super type. It will be immutable. When you have created an instance, you can use it in any number of graphs. It's not the running stage. It's the blueprint. So in this case, we're going to do a map, a transformation stage that takes a function that goes from one type to another and, you know, makes it possible to use that in a flow. So it will take elements of A coming in from one side and produce elements of type B on the other side. Doesn't change kind of the rate or anything like that. Pretty much downstream demands an element, and it will demand an element upstream. And there will be an element coming in, and it will push it out. So we define types and names of the inlet and the outlet of the stage. And then we give it a shape. So the shape allows us to do even more complicated stages, which has an arbitrary number of inputs and outputs. But in this case, it's kind of simple. So it's a flow shape. It has an in and an out. Then we have the part which is called every time this stage will be materialized. So create logic will be called to create the actual running graph stage. So every time you put it in a graph, nothing happens, and then you do run or materialize, and then the actual logic will be created by this one. So in this case, we don't have any state or anything, but the same kind of guarantees that holds true for actors also hold true for a graph stage. So you can have mutable state inside of your graph stage logic, and it will be totally safe, even though the stage will execute over different threads over time. So we set the handler for the output. So whenever there is a pull from downstream, we just pass that pull upstream. So we pull our inputs to kind of pass that demand on. And whenever there's input pushed onto us, we transform it with the function, and then we push it downstream. Okay. So this is sort of a state machine that, like the framework guarantees that if I try to push two elements, but there was only demand for one, I will get an exception. So it's kind of a safety net that makes it decently easy to write these kinds of stages. Yeah. So what I didn't mention is that it's a purely local abstraction. So a stream is something that you run on one node. It doesn't kind of spread out over many nodes or anything like that. So if you would, there is a project, an Intel project called GearPump, where they try to do it. So they take your stream blueprint and they kind of somehow distribute the parts of it over many nodes. I'm not sure how well that's going for them, but it's out there. But in general, when you want to scale out them, for example, you could still do that together with the other tools in Akka. So you would use Akka Cluster, for example, to make sure you run consumers for all the group IDs in a Kafka queue, whatever it's called, at a given time. And if one node is crashed or killed or someone pulls the power plug, then you can use the cluster tools to make sure that the stream will resurrect on a different node and continue processing. We have something like 200 active contributors, a very active community. If you're interested, then you can come to the public chat rooms on Gitter. And there's also, for like longer questions and kind of, I have built this, why doesn't it work? I think the mailing list is the best place to come ask. We also, if you want to contribute to the project, then we have marked up tickets in our issue management system. So the links, the really long, unreadable links in the bottom end, you can go there and see if there's anything that you're interested in contributing, if you want to contribute to an open source project. Okay, that was much faster than I anticipated. Sorry about that. So let's see if I did it so fast that no one understands and you have a lot of questions. No questions? Man, I did it really fast and everyone understood. That's insane. This is the most clever audience I ever had.
Actually, one.
Yeah.
How do you handle? I mean, okay, that you can have a cluster which is localized or remote, so there is a handling of part of the of how my graph can be distributed. But in case of JVM, do we need to manage our self executors, thread pools, or whatever, or it's configurable?
So that is configurable, but it's provided through the actor system, right? Because the streams run on top of actors, and then actors run on top of dispatchers, and dispatchers are based on, it's basically a richer wrapper around the thread pool or
do I require out of tuning for it?
I would say in general, you don't have to touch the stuff. It's fairly quick without any kind of tuning. You could probably, you know, get the last few drops out of it by. So the thing with the default dispatcher is based on the fork join pool, in Akka, and it bases the number of threads in the fork join pool on the number of cores on the machine. So if you're doing CPU bound work, that is like perfect, right? As long as you don't do any blocking, that's excellent. And if you do blocking, then you try to isolate that onto a different thread pool. So there's maybe not so much tuning, but selecting blocking things. So if you're going to use an input stream to read a file, right, then you're going to block until the file system comes back. And with the fork join pool, then it's built to do short jobs and turn the thread back to the thread pool. Right, so an asynchronous kind of version of this reading a file would be like telling the API that I want to read, and then later there will be something executed when there is data to work with, rather than blocking the thread, and I can hand it back. So then you can kind of create specific thread pools to do the blocking on.
I didn't quite get what the materializer is all about. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, sure. So the graph you have built is a blueprint, and you need to sort of compile that into a running stream. So the materializer is the thing that turns your blueprint into something that actually executes. And when that happens, there might be some output from it, right? So the blueprint, you can materialize it many times, just like a normal blueprint, right? You can draw the house and then you can build 5 houses. And for every house you actually build, then there can be some outcome. You get money from someone buying it, right? So that is the materialized value, that for every time you create a running instance of it, there can be some output. And the materializer is the thing that takes the blueprint and turns it into a running stream. So it will also do fusing, for example. So I was talking about this. There is it's too expensive to pass the synchronous boundaries all the time. So the materializer will take stages that are on the same asynchronous island, right? So you have a sync here and a sync there, and then you have like map, 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 map. And it will take all of those and fuse those together into a single state machine that will run on top of one actor. So that's the kind of work that the materializer does. Did that answer the question?
Thank you. A follow-up on this one. What would be the scenario for using multiple materializers, if ever, and would you configure them differently?
So materializers has a life cycle. When you stop the materializer, it will stop all the streams that the materializer is running with. So if you want to somehow have a bunch of streams that have their life cycle connected together, that might make sense to run them on one materializer and other streams on a different materializer. Could be. I don't have any kind of obvious reason. In general, I would, you know, it could. So they're more expensive than just a regular object because they will create actors and stuff, but they're not super expensive. So it would probably not be a problem if you create a few of them, but if you start creating like thousands and thousands, then it will be expensive.
It will probably result in a leak.
Yeah, it could. But so you would probably run your actor system with the JVM, right? You wouldn't kill the actor system. And as long as you don't kill the actor system, then the materializer will run because it runs on top of the actor system. So if you don't stop those materializers, If you create a new one for every incoming request, for example, and forget to close it, that will be a leak, yes. So in general, you can create one and then use it throughout your application, and that will be safe.
That would be also correct.
Yeah, if you don't want to tie their life cycle, like I mentioned, like you want to have all these 15 streams be killed at the same time in a simple way. So you have kind of compartments in your application like this. You have this part and you have this part.
Any other question?
Yeah, so actually as a part of the internal test kit, we do this. We kind of dump the diagram from into a dot file so we can draw it with GraphWiz or something like that. There is no public tool that does that yet, but we have some ideas for kind of future stuff that our design allows us to, right? So the problem in general with creating this kind of traversal is that you will need to touch internal APIs. And so the Akka project, we maintain binary compatibility across all minor versions. We never break binary compatibility. So if you have compiled your project with Akka 2.3.16, you can just take Akka 2.4.17 and drop into your project. You don't need to recompile it, and it will work, right? And since we maintain this, then the burden of making a lot of stuff public is, you know, the price of it is much higher. So there's quite a bit of stuff inside of the in the streams that is internal that we don't guarantee that will stay the same over time. So if you would do this as a side project, you would have to touch those APIs probably. Right. So you could probably do it, but it could break in minor versions.
One second, because we are recording the video.
When I have multiple implementations of the specification of the reactive streams, what does this actually mean? Does it mean they use the same concepts, or is there an actual integration possible?
So the whole thing is about library interoperability, right? So you could take an Akka stream and feed it into Vertex, for example. So that's the contact point, is the reactive streams API. We will provide you with a publisher, and they will have a subscriber in the reactive streams lingo. So you can connect those. And as long as both sides fulfill the specifications and, you know, follow the rules of it, then it will just work. Doesn't say anything about the internals of the implementation, right? So Vertex, they can have whatever they want on the other side of it, and we can do whatever we want on the inside of our part. I think Java RX and Reactor, they have taken the decision to make every step of their streams reactive streams. So that is a bit different, but it's nothing that the kind of the specification mandates. That is a design decision. Right.
Okay.
Yeah, feel free to come talk to me if you have some additional questions that you didn't want to kind of ask in public like this. And thanks a lot for listening.